that is dimensions 1 inch by 1 inch, and it's subjected to 20,000 pounds. Now we're just varying the angles of the oblique plane, 30, 45, and 60. So we want to see a variety or the variations in the stresses, both the tensile and the shear stress, based on the angle of theta. Now remember how we derived or defined the angle theta. Theta is between, let me go back to the picture here. The angle theta is always, always defined in this particular class with their formulas in particular, between the longitudinal axis of the member to the line that is normal to the oblique plane. So remember that. Now, if you're given a different angle, let's say I'm just going to make this up. You don't have to write this. Let's say that you're given this angle instead, right here. Or let me call this not theta, but right? That angle beta. That is not the same as our angle theta. So be careful with that. So if you're given some other angle, then you have to find your theta first. Okay, let me erase this because I don't want to confuse you guys here. Okay, so, but in our case, our angle theta is given, right? So we don't have to worry about finding the angle theta. So this is what I'm going to do. Since we have three different angles, I'm just going to make a chart. And I think I'm going to run out of space, but let me do my best here. So this is where I'm going to put my angle theta in this first column, and I'm going to solve for my, it doesn't matter which one you do first, but I got my shear stress and the formula that we derived on Monday. And I'm just going to write this formula down so I don't have to repeat this over and over again. Okay, notice that we have area A sub zero, which is not the same as A sub theta, right? That's the area of the oblique plane. We're going to start with angle 30, and you will see quickly how easy this is. I'm just going to go ahead and plug it in. So our force given is 20,000 pounds. Our angle theta is given as 30, so I'm just going to plug it in there. And our area, the original area, not the oblique plane, is defined by 1 inch by 1 inch. So we get our shear stress on an oblique plane with the angle theta of 30 is equal to 3,660 psi. Now what I'm going to do is, because I've done this problem entirely, I'm just going to go ahead and convert this to KSI. And the reason is because I want to be able to compare this shear stress at 30 degree angle to the shear stress at 45 and 60. And because of the significant figures, it might be easier for us to convert to KSI, not just for the 30 degrees, because we don't really need to, but for the next one, I used KSI. So I'm just going to go ahead and do that. Okay. So for angle of 30, my shear stress is equal to 8. Because of the light reflection on my paper, my 8 looked like 3, sorry. If you were calculating, you would have been like, oh, that's not supposed to be, sorry. I got my light right above me and sometimes it reflects on my paper. I can't really read my handwriting. Okay. Now I think I'll be okay because I'm holding onto my paper. Okay, so it's 8.66. Sorry about that. Okay, so I'm going to continue to my normal stress again. Same thing. And this formula makes it so much easier. Okay, so for the normal stress or tensile stress, at 30 degree angle works out to 15,000 pound per squared inch or 15,000 PSI. But as you know, you have to have four significant figures here. And this is the reason why I converted to the unit of KSI. So for the normal stress, we get 15.00 KSI. Now I'm going to continue and I will stop talking because it's pretty much the same thing. I'm just going to repeat the entire process for the angle of 45. Since I already told you that we're going to convert to KSI, I'm just going to do it right up here. So we got one more to go. Okay, so I did this pretty quickly because there was really no thinking involved. We did all of our thinking and analyses as part of deriving the formulas. There was really nothing other than substituting, right? But once you guys are done, I hope I did this correctly. I just did it so quickly. Let me double check. Let me see. I think it looks okay. My 8 does look like an 8. Okay, very good. Once you're done taking these notes, I want you guys to compare the shear stresses from 30 to 45 to 60, and do the same thing for the normal stress, normal stresses from 30 to 45 to 60. And once you guys start to see the pattern, that will help you to answer the part B of this question. Now, I cannot put everything into one page for you guys to see. You should probably see better on your own paper, but looking at the shear stress, when the angle is 30, it's 8.66 to 10 to back down to 8.66 KSI. And then for the normal stress, we're going from 15 to 10 to 5. So as the angle gets larger, your normal stress is getting smaller, right? Okay, let me see. I think some of you guys are still writing. Let me see. Okay, very good. Then I want you guys to think about part B of the question. It's asking for the maximum normal stress or the tensile stress. You guys can take a look at the three different stresses or at three different angles, or take a look at this picture as well. Meaning not just the actual value of the maximum stress, part of the question is asking you to determine exactly where do we get the maximum stress? Meaning specifically, what is the angle theta that will give you the maximum stress. So if you look at from 30 to 60, you're going from 15 to 10 to 5. So it's getting smaller and smaller. So as the angle gets larger, the stress gets smaller, right? Any thought?
It would be zero.
Wait, I missed someone saying. Who was that?
Ryan.
Ryan is on my last page. Ryan, you said zero?
Yes, if the theta equals zero.
Excellent. Theta has to equal zero. So let's go ahead and put that angle zero there and see what happens. Let me put back the formula for our oblique plane. Okay, so Ryan says the angle theta must be zero to give us the maximum stress. So I did that, okay? And cosine of zero is what?
One,
right? So one times anything gives you the same number, right? It's an identity. So I got 20,000, 1, 2, 3, 4 pounds inch square. For consistency, I'm going to convert again. And we get 20.0 KSI when the angle theta is equal to zero. So if the angle is equal to zero, what would your shear stress be?
Zero.
Very good. Okay. When angle theta is equal to zero, there is no oblique plane. Right? It's passing a cutting plane right through without any oblique plane. And that's when you have no shear stress, but only left with the normal stress, and the normal stress will be at its maximum. Okay, very good. Then I know this is not part of this question, but I'm going to ask anyway. Then what about the maximum shear stress.
The angle is 90 degrees, I'm guessing?
Not quite.
It's at 45, right?
Who said that? Was it Ryan again?
No, it was me, Colin.
Sorry, Colin. Very good. You're going to get maximum shear stress when the angle theta is equal to 45. Very good. Okay. At the angle 45, what were our shear stress and normal stress for this particular example?
10 and 10 KSI.
They were the same, right? Okay. Very good. Very good. Okay. This is as hard as it gets for oblique plane. Now, I said to you before on Monday, you have this particular, I wouldn't say technique, but formulas, right? The two formulas that we derived on Monday in class, right? These two formulas you have for calculating for any stress at any angle theta, or, and we will do this at the very end of the semester because that's our last topic. We're going to be covering the Mohr's circle. Again, that's a graphical representation to show the variations in the stresses for both the normal and for the shear stress. That to me is very complicated compared to these two formulas because it's not like you can just straightforward substitution and find the variations in the stresses. There's a lot more work involved. And of course, the application of the Mohr circle will go beyond just doing these two simple calculations. But I want you guys to remember these two formulas because eventually when we get to the Mohr circle, I want you guys to be able to see the differences between the two techniques. Okay, but for now, we're done covering the topics in chapter one. So we're done with chapter one. But before we start chapter two, and by the way, chapter two is going to be very lengthy because we're going to be covering both the stresses and strains and deformation in chapter two. So chapter two is the most, I think in this class, the most important chapter. But before I do that, let me switch over to, I don't think you guys can see this. So let me stop sharing that. And okay. Oh, by the way, did you have any questions on the last example? I forgot to ask if you guys had any questions. Questions, comments, too easy, straightforward, right?
Last quiz?
No, the example that we just did.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Okay, so there are two particular homework problems that I want you guys to look at. And I hope you guys had a chance to do that. 1.23 and 1.24. I would like to go over these two before we start chapter two, because I want to make sure you guys can understand the difference, differences across the three different stresses that we talked about in chapter one. Especially, it's important that you understand the shearing stress, because the shearing stress is not going to go away. We're going to see it over and over again in this class. So 1.23 isn't too hard, but did you guys have a chance to work through 1.23? Did anyone look at 1.23? I'm going to ask you guys questions then. Okay. So this is kind of similar to, 1.7 that we looked at in this class? I forget the exact problem number, but we saw something similar to this. So you have link AB and you're given its dimensions. The width is 2 inches, the thickness is 1/4 inch, used to support the end of a horizontal beam. And we're being shown a part of that horizontal beam, right? Knowing that the average normal stress in the link is -20 KSI, and this is what you need to be careful with. When you see that the normal stress in the link is -20 KSI, what should we be thinking of when we see this negative sign?
Was it that it's compressive?
Excellent. It's compressive stress, right? That means in order to induce a compressive stress, what does this tell you about the applied load P?
It's equal to that? I mean, an opposite.
No, meaning that the load P should have been compressive as well to induce compressive stress. Tensile force induces tensile stress. Compressive should be compressive. Compressive force induces compressive stress. Okay. The average shearing stress in each of the two pins is 12 KSI. Determine the diameter D of the pins and the average bearing stress in the link. So there is a lot going on in this example problem or in this homework problem. Oh, there's a, did someone send me a message? Oh, okay. Okay, very good. So given this, how should we start? Kind of give you a hint already. We're looking for the diameter D in part A. So if you start with a formula for stress, what is missing?
The area.
The area, very good, because the diameter is missing, very good. But do we know about the load P? Do we know about the stress? And there are two stress considerations here. One is the normal stress of negative 20 KSI. And in part B, we're given the, shear stress is limited to 12 KSI. And in part B, we have the average, we're looking for the average bearing stress. So there's a lot of stresses, right, going on here. The normal stress, the shear stress, and the bearing stress. So we definitely do not know the area because, of course, we do not know the D. Okay, but since we have three different stresses being discussed here, in part A, what stress are we referring to in part A? It's telling us that the normal stress induced is 20 KSI. So when you're given that, this is the actual stress developing in the link, right? So this should be a hint for you to figure out, because we don't know the area, then what can we figure out then? We can figure out the load P that is responsible for inducing the normal stress of negative 20 KSI. And this is in the link. And what do we know about the link? We know its dimensions. Given its dimensions, we should be able to figure out its area. Okay. So we know the stress induced, we know the area of the cross section. So we should be able to figure out the load P responsible for causing a compressive stress of 20 KSI. Now, if you're thinking, okay, so what does that mean? We're looking for the diameter given that the shear stress is 12 KSI. Well, the load P has to be the same. You cannot have separate or two different types of loads in this link. Okay, so once we figure out the load P, we can apply that load P to figure out the diameter of the D, knowing that the shear stress is 12 KSI. So sometimes it helps to read the entire problem as a whole rather than break it apart into parts A and B. So that's what I'm going to do first. First, find the load P. For inducing the compressive stress of 20 KSI. So I'm going to start with my formula for the normal stress. Again, I know the stress. I should be able to figure out the area. I don't know the load. So rewriting my formula, P is equal to sigma times A. Now you don't necessarily have to carry out the negative sign, but since it's given to us, I'll just do that, but it just means compressive, as Jaehyun said. Okay, then how do I determine the area for the link? Let me go back to the problem statement so you guys can help me to identify it. So link AB of width B equal to 2 inches and thickness T equal to 1/4 inch. That's already telling us the dimensions of the cross-sectioning plane or the area of the link, right? So we got the B here and we have the thickness right here. So when we pass a cutting plane, it's rectangular in shape, determined by B and T. B is 2, T is 1/4 or 0.25 inches. Inch square canceled out. P is therefore minus 10 kip, but of course this negative sign, that means compressive. That's all it means in this case. Okay, so let's take a look at part A. Unfortunately, the way the problem statement has been written, it's kind of confusing, but I would read this as this. In part A, knowing that the average normal stress in the link is negative 20 KSI and the average shearing stress of each of the two pins is equal to 12 KSI. So I'm gonna take that. So shear stress is equal to 12 KSI. Of the pins, right? So let me see if I can draw this picture similar to the one that we saw before in a different homework problem. Compressive, right? Let me start with the formula here. Again, I forget who mentioned this. We do not have the area, so I'm going to rewrite this. My area would be pi. Oh, wait, let me ask you this. I kind of started to write this, but I was going to ask you guys, can you guys visualize in this picture for the link and the two pins where the shearing would be taking place?
In the pins.
Very good. Either up here, right? Or down here, right? Okay. And we're given the diameter. Maybe I should erase this here. We're given the diameter. We're not given the diameter. We're looking for the diameter. We're looking for the diameter D, right? Okay. So when you pass a cutting plane through the pin, can you guys visualize the formula for the area? Is it solid? Is it hollow? What shape is it? Is it rectangular, square, circle?
You take the area of half the circle and then subtract the diameter of the circle inside it.
Wait, say that again? Okay. Drew, can you say that again?
You just take the half of the one circle, right? Because it's a half circle, isn't it? And then just subtract the one that's inside it.
No. If you were to visualize the shearing plane as if as you're pushing the link against it, right? How does it shear off? It's going to cut the pin. If it's harder to think of the compressive force, think about a tensile force, right? You're going to shear it off. So you're going to take a piece of rod and shear it off. And when you do, look at its cross-section and plane, it will just simply be a circle because you're going to take this pin out, right? This is the pin that's inserted through the link. And when you pass a cutting plane, it is just circular, okay? So the area A is for the solid, pi d squared over 4. Rewriting this formula to find the diameter. Our P, we found it in the first step, which was 10 kips or negative 10, but I'm just going to write it as 10 kips. Because when it comes to the shearing, it doesn't matter whether it's compressive or tensile, the effect will be pretty much the same thing. And then we got 12 KSI. Replacing KSI with kip divided by, that's supposed to be inch, not pound. It looks like a, okay. Kips are canceled out. I'm left with inch square, which makes sense because I'm solving for the diameter. And the diameter that we get, the required diameter is 1.030 inches. Okay, part B, that's where it gets harder. This is for the bearing stress. Okay, determine the bearing stress in the link. So I'm gonna start with the formula for the bearing stress. And as you guys recall, all the stress formulas are pretty much the same, P over A. The major difference here, just like in the shear stress formula, the normal stress formula is in the area A. And this is the part that I wanted you guys to read in your textbook as part of this homework. Again, it says here the bearing stress in the link. And what is in the link? You have a pin going through it, right? Sometimes, well, let me go back to the picture. It's in 3D, right? So sometimes it's easier. I'm gonna take this portion out and simplify it into a 2D picture. So what's inside the link? There's a pin going in there, right? So if I were to take this out, let me go down. The thickness was given, right? This is a side view of the link. And through it is your pin. And between the link and the pin by being inserted into the link, there's a contact surface between the pin and the link, right? Because the pin is embedded into the link. So it is, it's gonna be hard to kind of sketch this, but it's exerting contact pressure. The pin is exerting contact pressure against the inside of the link. And that's what you're looking for in this case, the bearing stress in the link because of the pin. So how do we determine the area of the contact surface between the pin and the link? So when I was a student, I was like, okay, so if you were to take that cylindrical shape of the pin inside the link and unravel it and look at the surface area of it, that's what I thought, but no. Okay, and this is why I wanted you guys to read that particular section in your textbook, because it's not as intuitive. It's exerting a cylindrical shape, pin is exerting a contact or the compressive force inside the link. And what they do with this formula derivation is that they're looking at the simplified version of this. And it's not like you are going to unravel the pin and then look at the surface area, but it's a projected image. And the projected image of the pin inside the link is determined by the diameter of the pin and the thickness of the link. And that's why the formula in the book gives you D times T. Again, I wanted you guys to read this in your textbook because they have a better picture to explain to you the projected image of the surface area, okay? Because it's not like you take the cylinder and unravel it, because that's not the right way to do it. So I was wrong too when I was a student. So it looks like this. Okay, inside the link. So again, our force was 10. Again, you can leave out the negative sign for compressive. My D in this case is what we found in part A. And the thickness of the link is 0.25. And for the bearing stress in the link exerted by the pin is 38.8 KSI. And you guys have to know this formula for sure. And this is the one that I was referring to you guys about the bearing stress for the connections. Okay, I know this takes some time for you guys to get used to be able to see the difference between like the example we did in class for the bearing stress between the wood and the circular steel plate, right? That's different from this problem. Okay, so you guys have to be able to see the difference. One is sitting on top of the other, whereas this pin is inserted, projecting its compressive force all throughout inside the link. So there is a fundamental difference between the two. Now this part sets us up for the next problem, which is 1.24. So we're not done with this formula. Where's my 1.24? I know it's here. This is what looks scary, 1.24. Again, all these pictures are going to be given to you in three-dimensional, but you guys can actually simplify this into a 2D pictures. So you have in this picture, you have a link and you got two supports going on here at B and C. The member AB is connected to a cable, which is connected to the support at C. So determine the largest load P that can be applied at A when theta, that's the angle of inclination of the member AB, is equal to 60 degrees, knowing that the average bearing stress in the 10 millimeter diameter pin at B must not exceed 120 megapascal, and the average bearing stress in member AB. Where's the rest of my problem statement? Oh, okay. Oh no, this is it. It looks a lot more in my handwritten notes. And the bearing stress in member AB and the bracket at B must not exceed 90 megapascal. So we're looking for the force P, but take a look at the rest of the highlighted portion of this problem. There's so much information going on here. You have the shearing stress. Then you have the bearing stress, not just a member AB, but at the bracket, the support at B. So if I read a problem like this, where it says must not exceed, where is the other one, right? When I see these words, I am immediately thinking of constraints. So these are our constraints or limitations that we need to satisfy. We cannot violate these constraints. So having or being able to identify these constraints, I'm going to ask you the next question. How many constraints are we dealing with in this problem? Okay, I see fingers going up. I see two. Anybody else?
Three.
Okay, I think that was Jason. Mm-hmm. Jason says three. I saw two fingers go up. So for those of you who kind of put your fingers up and Jason included, can you guys tell me some of those constraints?
Well, we're pinned at B. The cable should keep B from pushing A down too much. So I'm saying we're probably constrained at C as well. So we're constrained at B, we're constrained at C.
Okay, maybe let me rephrase a problem statement here, Jason. Okay, so given, by reading this problem statement at hand, can you guys identify those specific constraints, either two or three that I've heard from you guys? So can you identify the first constraint from the problem statement? I guess that's what I'm asking. Let me help you here. Shear stress in the 10 millimeter diameter pin at B. So here's my pin right here, right? Going through, that's my pin. The shear stress is limited to 120 megapascal, right? Must not exceed. But of course, I'm gonna take this inequality and then turn that into a maximum so that we can find the maximum value of P, right? Constraint number two. Basically, take your problem statement and then convert it into a mathematical form. That's all I'm asking. The average bearing stress in member AB must not exceed 90 megapascal. That's a condition, don't you think? It's a constraint that we need to work within, right? So it says the bearing stress, sigma sub B, must not exceed 90 megapascal. But then it says here, in member AB and in the bracket at B. So we're looking at bearing stress in two different places. And that's why I think Jason said there are three constraints. And that's what makes this problem difficult. Okay, so we're looking at one constraint of shear stress, but two constraints of bearing stress in two different places. Every time you have a constraint, either one, two, or three in this case, I think I've given a maximum of three constraints. I don't think I've ever given a problem on a test or on a quiz more than three constraints at a time. So every time you have a constraint, you have to address every single constraint. If you happen to get lucky and you chose the right constraint to find the load P, does that mean that you ignore the other constraints? Absolutely not. I have to see your work for every single constraint. Okay, if I don't see every single constraint being addressed, the work will be considered incomplete. This is the mechanical engineering part. That's where what we've learned in chapter one in this class come into play. But before that, we have to do something else. Before we get to EGR-246 stuff, we have to do something else. And what is that something else that we need to do for this problem? If you look at every one of these formulas, you have P over A, P over A, with a major difference in the way the areas are calculated. Okay, because these are different areas of at which the stresses are developing. But what else is missing here? Are these P values in this formulas, are these the P values of this P in the problem statement? Jason? I saw you shaking your head no. And that's
no, that P is for the whole system. If we're looking at the one link in it, the P is going to be different.
Very good. If you look at the shear stress constraint, 120 megapascal in the 10 millimeter diameter, right? So what is causing that force? You have to be looking at the member AB. Everything is related to the member AB. There's no question being addressed in relation to the cable between A and C. All these constraints are related to member AB of this structure. Okay, so you have to find the force in member AB that is responsible for satisfying these conditions. And I think Jason said this before, and ultimately for the overall system that affects the force P. So again, I have a problem with the textbook using the same letter over and over again, because it's kind of misleading to say that find the force P, but then there's force P in our formulas. So this formula P is not the same as this P in the problem. Formulas, the letter P represents the load P, right? In general, it does not mean this specific P in this problem 1.24. So what we need to do first is to find F sub AB, right? Okay, so in order to, let's go back to what Jason said, you have to look at the entire system. So how are we going to relate F sub AB, okay, that is responsible for all of these stresses to the force P that is applied in this problem? Jason said, look at the entire system, right? So let's take a look at the entire system. Meaning what? What do we need to do? And you guys already know this answer. You just don't realize it.
Resolve P and from the angle so that it acts along AB.
Okay. You're getting warmer, Jason. That means what? You have to look at the entire structure, your entire system of forces. So again, the key here is to relate your force P right here to the force in member AB. Go back to your statics. This is where your statics comes in. You cannot do this class without statics. So going back to statics, chapter two, what should we do?
Could we?
Let me help you here. Free body diagram of the entire system of forces. So what would you, and this is the same question I asked you guys in statics, what would you isolate as part of this free body diagram? What do we need to remove from the entire system?
AB.
Not quite, because again, I want to be able to relate the force in AB to the unknown force P. That's our ultimate question. Think back to chapter 2 on equilibrium. That's where we drew a free body diagram for every equilibrium problems. And I used to always say, free body diagram of what? What is common to the force P and the force member AB?
The point A.
Who said that? Ty? Excellent. Why point A? Point A is referred to as what? From your statics. Let me help you here.
Point of application.
Sure, but it's a point of concurrency, remember? I said always look for that point of concurrency for the forces, if you can. Once you identify that, that point of concurrency becomes the origin of your X and Y coordinate system. Here's my point A. Let me do this in different colors so you guys can see better. I'm going to start with the force P that we're looking for. It's going straight down at point A. Then you have the member AB and AC, the cable, right? Because the three forces, P, the force in the cable AC, and the force in member AB, just because we're not concerned with AC does not mean that we ignore it. It's part of the system, right? So I'm going to put AC in this fourth quadrant. And I can't put all the forces in the fourth quadrant, so let me put AB using its line of action. Oops, doesn't look that straight. In the second quadrant instead. And we know from the problem statement that theta is equal to 60 degrees. So I got my three forces here concurrent at point A. I'm missing the senses. So I'm going to assume the cable is in tension. And I'm going to assume that AB is also in tension. What else am I missing here? So let me ask you this. How would I go about solving for the force in member AB? Or how do I represent it? Well, actually, we're looking for P, so let's use the P. How would I represent the force P? If you were in statics, how would you solve for P? That's what I'm asking. What do we do in statics to solve for unknown forces?
Equilibrium.
Equilibrium, very good. Some of the forces must be equal to zero, right? Some of the forces in the x equal to zero, some of the force in the y equal to zero. Now, if I'm going to resolve my forces and components, take a look at F sub AC. Do I know its angle of inclination? Meaning right here, do I know its angle of inclination? So there are embedded questions throughout. And these are the steps that you have to take before you actually apply the formulas we learned in this class. So like a third or maybe a quarter of this problem is dedicated to your statics. And until your statics is done, you can move over to the mechanics of material stuff. So the question is, I need to have that angle of inclination. How are we going to find that? Take a look at the problem given. I know mine is messy because I wrote all over it, but the information is there. Take a look at its dimensions. Can you guys see a triangle anywhere in this original picture? Oh boy. If I give you a problem,
the base is 750 millimeters. The one of the sides is 750, and then the hypotenuse is going to be the A to C.
Okay, very good. So you have an oblique. Wait, let me take this out. So you have. Let's get a. Oops, that's my pencil. Okay. Right. You got 750 here. You got 750 here.
Yep.
Right? Very good. Let me take that out here. It's not drawn to scale. Okay. So this is where our force P is located, right? And what do I know about this? Right here for AB is 60 degrees.
That's 60 degrees.
Yep. Exactly, Jason. Very good. So can you tell me what this would be? That's your supplementary angle, right? That would give you 120.
120.
Exactly, right. So that means because of the dimensions that Jason has recognized, AB and BC, even though in my picture, their lengths do not look the same, but it's an isosceles, maybe I should write that. Triangle ABC is an isosceles triangle. Right? Because AB is the same as BC. That means their angles gotta be the same. Therefore, angle at A should be the same as angle at C. And what is that angle equal to?
What is it? 60 divided by 2, so 30 degrees.
Excellent. That's your 30 degrees. Okay. So if this is 30 right here, right? This is 30. Now we're getting somewhere. But ultimately, what are we looking for? We're looking for, this is my x-axis right here. This is the angle of inclination for the force in AC, right? So this is a right triangle, 60, 30, 90, right? So for the theta sub x, then should be equal to,
that's 30 degrees. It's
30 degrees.
30 degrees. Very good. Has to be 30. Okay. Let me go back up. Let me put my 30 right there. Just to get that angle of inclination, we had to be able to see using the dimensions given. That is an isosceles triangle. Therefore, the two internal angles got to be the same, right? And using this right angle right here between y and x, we know that the total got to be adding up to 90, and therefore theta sub x works out to be 30 degrees. Okay, so now that our free body diagram is complete, we're going to apply our equilibrium equations. And let me go ahead and do that. I'm going to do this quickly because this is a review. I hope you guys have your free body diagram because mine's way up there, so I can't really go back and forth quickly. So I'm going to start with F sub A being the second quadrant. When resolved into X, that's a negative. Okay, so I got negative F sub AB times cosine 60 plus F sub AC times cosine 30 equal to 0. Two unknowns in one equation, I know I cannot solve for either or, but my ultimate goal is to find P. I don't really care for F sub AC. I do care about F sub AB. This I care about. This I don't really care for, right? Let's go to some of the forces in the y equal to 0. I'm going to leave some space above. Then I'm going to start with the force P. It's coming straight down, so minus P. Okay. So when I do some of the forces in the Y go to zero, I do have my P, and again, that's my ultimate goal, right? So of the three forces that we have, I care about the force P, I care about the force in member AB, because that's where all the constraints are around, but I don't really care for F sub AC. Doesn't mean that we ignore F sub AC, right? So in these two equations, I got two unknowns in the first one, I got three unknowns in the second equation. So a total of, we have three unknowns in this problem. Could you have solved for the force P in statics? You can't. This would have been determined as statically indeterminate because you have two equations with three unknowns, and that would not have been possible. That's why you never ever had a problem like this in statics. Okay, so let me go back to my first one. And since I don't care for F sub AC, I want to get rid of F sub AC. So I'm going to find F sub AC in terms of F sub AB. And when I do that, I got F sub AB times cosine of 60 divided by cosine of 30. Again, that's because I don't really care for F sub AC, because if we're in statics, yes, I do care, but we're not in statics. So if you don't need to have it, then try to eliminate it as soon as you can. Then we're going to take this and then make substitution right here. We've done this many times in your statics. Let's make the substitution. Notice that F sub AC has been eliminated. We're left with P and F sub AB, and that's all I care about. Now, again, we want to find P. So I'm going to write P in terms of F sub AB. And the coefficient that we get is 0.5774 times F sub AB. Now we're stuck, right? We have two unknowns in this one reduced equation. We can't solve for P yet because we do not know F sub AB. This is where these come into play. We're going to use these constraints to solve for the force in member AB. Once we've done F sub AB, we go back to this equation and then solve for P. So again, there's a lot more work to be involved. So let's go ahead and do each one. So I'm going to start with constraint one. Was shear stress in the pin is limited to, 120 megapascal. Okay, so shear stress, the maximum is then equal to 120 megapascal at pin B. So I'm gonna start with my formula. Now the formula is just a generic expression. Be careful with the fact that this P is not the same as this P right here. So before we get confused, I'm going to rewrite this to say that this is referring to the force in member AB divided by A. Okay, so be careful with that. Let's rewrite this because we're looking for the force in member AB. So my F sub AB is equal to the shear stress, the maximum, times the area. And this is where I think it helps. Going back to the original picture, let me quickly go back and then come back to it. So here's my pin right here at B. Even though this is three-dimensional, I'm going to try to look at its side and then try to identify the planes of shear. So taking that portion, I'm going to try to draw this from a side view. So this is where your F sub AB, the force would be. And you have on each side of maybe I should draw this more. So you have the bracket, this is at B, right? The bracket at B, right? And then you have the pin that's inserted. Can you guys, does this help to like visualize from the side view?
Yes.
Okay. Then let me ask you this. We know there's a force F sub AB that's being exerted to the pin at B. Whether it's pulling on it or it's, but according to our sign convention for the free body diagram, we assume that F sub A to B tensile, right? So the tensile force in link AB, where's my picture? Oh, here, is pulling on it. So can you guys see the shearing action taking place? This is very similar to our example problem on clevis pin in class. Where do you see the shearing action taking place?
Okay.
Okay, very good. Okay. How many planes of shear do you see?
Two.
Two, excellent. One, two. Okay, so we have two planes of shear. Our shear stress 120 megapascal, and then we have two shearing planes. Okay, now that we have this 120 millimeter square. I'm just going to leave the 2 here, 2 pi over 4. What is our diameter of the pin? Oh, you guys don't have the problem statement in front of you? Okay.
10 millimeters.
Very good. It's the 10 millimeters. Very good. Okay. Very good. Millimeter squares canceled out. So the F sub AB, the force in member AB that will satisfy the shearing stress constraint, works out to 18,849.5559 newtons. Now we're not done. We got three constraints. F sub AB of this magnitude satisfies just one of the three constraints. So this is not yet our final or part of the final answer. You can't just take this F sub AB and then go back to here and then plug it in to find the force P. We're not done. Oh man, I'm running out of time, but let's start the second constraint. This is a bearing stress, maximum of 90 megapascal in member AB. Now, this is where it gets a little confusing between constraint two and constraint three, because they are both bearing stresses, right? Again, the formula says it's P over A, but remember that this P is not the same as the P in the question. This is your F sub AB. Okay, so we get our F sub AB equal to the bearing stress times the area. Before I let you guys go, let's take a look at this picture, because this is not the same as in part C for the brackets. Okay, so again, it's much easier if I draw a picture, something similar to what I did in the constraint one. So I'm going to take the side view of the link right here. Then on each side, we have the bracket. Then we have our pin that's inserted. Okay, again, this is our F sub AB, assume that that's tensile, right? So if we're talking about the bearing stress in member AB, our member AB is right here, right? It's our link. And the bearing stress we're referring to is the bearing stress exerted by the pin in the link AB. But then you also have the pin that is going through the two brackets. That is part, that's the third constraint. But for the constraint that is referring to AB, we're only concerned about this portion right here. Okay, but as you can see, I don't wanna mess this up, but you have the two brackets. One bracket here, the second bracket here. You also have the pin that's going through the brackets. That is your third constraint, not to be confused with the second constraint for member AB. So we know the bearing stress, but what formula then should we use for the pin that is going through the member AB?
It's the one we used last time. Instead of unwrapping the inner circle here, we're just going to times the thickness by the diameter.
Excellent. This is where this formula comes back in. Okay. Unfortunately, I'm going to have to let you guys go, but I already told you that this problem was going to be a very lengthy one because it's an excellent problem. It's a very integrated problem. Okay, but I think you guys are getting the hang of it, right? Being able to see the difference, especially in the bearing stress between the member and at the brackets at B. And it's very helpful if you guys can quickly sketch what you guys are looking at, right? Even though the picture is in 3D given, you can just reduce it down to 2D and it just makes it a lot easier. I know we're out of time, so I'm gonna have to come back and finish this up with you on Monday. You don't have to finish it, but